Dr. Gabriela Hoyt. She's the president of WiN, Women in Nuclear Global. And we both want to welcome you, PWN Vienna, WiN Global, IAEA WiN members and guests, as well as members of the Diplomatic Academy community.
I'm the president of Women in Nuclear Global. This is a non-governmental organization, non-profit. I'm presently in the States to register us in Vienna as an international NGO. It has more than 35,000 members worldwide from more than 100 countries or regions. And our major goal is to support women working in the nuclear environment. And this is not only support of nuclear energy, but also the support of any nuclear applications in a wider sense. And most of the people, when they hear nuclear, they get afraid, or they get scared or panicky, because you hear about nuclear issues in the news concerning accidents, Chernobyl, Fukushima, or threats to the population. For more than 13 years, is saying the two sides of nuclear. One is the more threatening parts, it's also the control of nuclear weapons, non-proliferation treaty, which are very familiar to most of you. But the other side is the use of nuclear for peaceful applications such as sterile insect technology, which is done in the laboratories in Cyberstock, the application in food and agriculture at large, environmental protection, in health issues. And imagine, you cannot imagine a hospital nowadays without nuclear facilities which can provide diagnosis and treatment which uses nuclear applications. So for the world, and licensing women in order to allow them to make a career in the nuclear environment or getting even a job there if possible.
She has the position of Vice President Strategy, Government Affairs and Advocacy for Areva, the world's largest global nuclear energy company. And she served in the US government for over 15 years in the area of non-proliferation and nuclear energy. By the way, Dr. René Gatzen is a curator, global vice president in the aging man, and participate on steering committees for Mercer's winning efforts. Please join me in welcoming our guest speakers to the stage.
In the age of social media that we now live in, these pictures get tweeted and go viral and all that kind of stuff. So I thought,
I like the energy because it also helps me get energized on a topic. I have a lot of things to talk about with respect to data, and I think, thank you very much, you helped me get rid of that off the table right away. Basically, I'm Mary Alice Hayward, and I'm at the International Atomic Energy Agency. I've been there 5 months, and I have been very excited to learn a lot of great things about leadership. But I decided not to do my prepared remarks, because what I've realized is we all now have the data, we now have the stage set.
At the end of the day, if I can give back through mentoring, through encouraging people to stay in science, but most importantly, figure out how to retain the expertise and motivate women, I feel like I have made a little bit of contribution to the society that I have been lucky to be part of. And so with that, I'll wrap up, and I look forward to just interacting with my colleagues up here and hearing your questions. Thank you.
And other women, as you were talking about, empower other women, that women are fine. They're not dirty, they're not crippled, they're not stupid. These are cultural constructions that have been created over thousands of years and propagated through culture, through religion, and through other structures. So I'm so convinced of this, it's very easy for me to explain to everyone that women and men are absolutely equal in every way.
And one that doesn't. And I've seen it, and I hadn't actually consciously thought about it as much until I came to the IAEA, and it was a thing. Gender was a topic, people were talking about it. And I
started to look around and I said, I can reflect now. I can see where the bosses, the leaders at the top of the organization, if they cared about it, they would start doing something about it. And that proliferates down to the bottom of the organization and it ricochets around and you start seeing different behavior. That's the first start. Obviously, the other things about, you know, STEM is very important, encouraging the women to stay in the field, and but we're also talking about a millennial generation that is different in terms of how they see themselves and their gender and each other. They're more diverse, generally speaking. They don't see themselves as segregated between boys and girls as much. They're more globally connected, so if they're, and I'm just generalizing, of course. So we think maybe my generation, being my views onto where I think the millennials are, I think it's us older folks that have a problem. But we're now in positions of leadership. So for me, in order to make the first change, a big change, is you have to, in an organization, when you start taking that number from 170 down to 150, 160, I hadn't heard that statistic before. I just know from what I'm observing now, it's 29% in an organization. The organization is 60 years old, and I'm 23. And that just tells me that there's a lot more to do, and it's got to start from the tip top. And
one of the things we talked about a lot of person is the men starting to value more, childcare, out of care, all the things that women traditionally have done more than men. And I think we are seeing that now. So I'm seeing a lot more men, for example, wanting to take care of their families. And I think organizations now need to start making it easier for men to take paternity leave. Have the culture where if you take paternity leave, you're not seeing some kind of weakling who doesn't really cut it in the business world, because that's the thing that women have had to put up with for a long time, right? So the other thing we talk about is flexible working, okay? Men need to start working more flexibly, okay? Because that's, again, something that will benefit them, and also if you've got flexible working, it'll have benefit women as well. It's all about changing the norm. So what we need from the male side, we need leaders that are role models that are doing things differently. And I've challenged our leaders at Mercer. I said, you guys need to start working more flexibly, you need to start taking paternity leave, you need to start being very visibly balancing up the other side of this equation, okay? Because we do need to get to zero and we need to get there faster. And I wouldn't possibly offer any recommendations to the women present because I think you've got lots of fabulous recommendations already. But maybe one of the things I would just kind of encourage is, be bolder about what you're capable of. Because from what I've seen in our organization and just generally, women are capable of amazing things just as much as men. So don't hold back because you haven't got the 99.9% thing, just go for it, basically. And I think that'll do something, I think, towards closing,
Open over here, and I think you would be good for it. We need to be sure that we are working within our various women's networks, whether it's just a coworker or if it's a specific mentoring type of organization, to do that sort of encouragement. And it's not to necessarily exclude people or exclude men from those opportunities, but to really look for opportunities to help each other move forward. And I think that that's going to be very important when you start talking about the pipeline in getting people to think of themselves in those roles and to start with the youngsters that we see in the audience here in the early career stage. And for those of us that are on the other side of the career stage, I think we have an obligation to not just be the role model in our individual work, but to be the specific sort of push that they might need to develop themselves.
Or taking it on, because I think there's many years why certain people don't want to give up their roles, and which I think is independent of gender. But men have their roles, and I think they identify very much with their position and power. And if they, I think when you call it privilege, I think if it's taken away, they need a new identity. And I think we need to work on giving every person confidence in the different roles they have. So I'm curious about what you see, what your fears were, or what you discovered, and what you see with the male colleagues you talk to.
I remember going to the school gates with, you know, Sarah and Stefan, and some of the mums looking at me like, you know, what's he doing here? You know, he must be unemployed. You know, he's bringing the kids to school, you know. And then equally at work, you know, one of other male colleagues sort of thinking, so why is he at the, you know, kind of, I was almost tempted to put my jacket on the back of the chair. That she's had from women, that they've had from men, that were examples of the microaggressions and the sexist mm-hmm. behaviour. And it was amazing. She started this website and she became flooded with these contributions from women every day, little things that were experiencing. And it got to the point where she wrote a book about it, and I read the book, and it's compulsory reading for all men, because it gives you an insight into what it's like to be a woman. For example, having to walk down the street and being physically unsafe, or being talked over in a meeting, or being assumed you're the secretary, and will you please take the notes and make the copy? So one of the things that we're starting to do, we just started this to build the empathy, is we're going to use virtual reality technology. And we've just done this at Mercer. It was really fun to do it. So we recorded some episodes of misogynistic behaviour using a virtual reality headset. And then we got men to put the headset on and basically experience the reaction as a woman, basically, because it's been filmed from a woman's perspective. And it's been enormously enlightening to the men, okay, of actually what it's really like to be ignored, for example. So in this example, the woman was being ignored, and the guy, you know, when he's watching it with a virtual reality headset on, can't believe that that's actually happening. You know, so I guess the broader question is, how do we build more empathy? How do we build more understanding of what each other's experience is? Whether it's the women in the double shift and the sexual biases or whatever, or it's the man and the actor syndrome and all the pressures that we have. You know, we need that empathy for each other. So I think that's kind of part of the thing I think we need. And let's think of some creative new ways to try and build that empathy. I mean, virtual reality is just one way. Talking to each other is a very good one too, actually. But I think building empathy is absolutely essential if we want to have gender balance and, you know, gender balance in each.
If you wouldn't mind, I think that's a beautiful closing statement and comments on morality. You're human, I'm human. Empathy is what it's about. Yeah, we all need each other to keep our little spaceship planet Earth going. So let's start today instead of tomorrow to understand each other, to support each other, and to raise each other up. Because men are not happy when women are slaves and peasants, and women are not happy when they're slaves and peasants of men. So let us move forward in the cultural world, in the corporate world, in the world of NGOs and international organizations. And I'm so thankful to Simone, who now concludes our session, that she invited me to be here tonight. And I appreciate being on such a very, very top panel as sort of the oddball out coming from the art scene.
We have a small award, Simone.